turn. You think that I know everything. And you crowd me, bursting with your questions. Questions you cannot even formulate. You think that I know the answers. All I know are facts. Life. Death. Truth. I returned for truth, for there, everything was true. Everything was stamped with truth, immortal truth, clear and sharp without nuance or measure. Pure cruelty, pure horror. Who could bear to face the truth in that cruelty? Close eyes forever or look on wide-eyed. Wild-eyed, the only choice, the only chance. The light sear the eyes that dare to seek. So why should I speak? For the things I would say cannot be of any use to you.
She knows her life doesn't matter anymore. each of us looks to the others? Would you want all those lives to have been destroyed here? All those cadavers to remain mute for all eternity? All those lives to have been sacrificed for nothing?
It's exactly that, for nothing. To die here in this place whose name we don't even know. Perhaps it has no name.
There will be one who returns, one who will give it its name.
Here, at the frontiers of the inhabited world, yes, it's to die for nothing. It's already as if we were dead.
If the world never knows anything about it. But there will be one who returns, one who will talk and who will tell and who will make known, because it is no longer we who are at stake here, it's history. And people want to know their history. Haven't you heard them? The dying, who all say, if you return, you'll tell. Why do they say that? They say that because none of us is alone and each must render an account to the others.
The others? Other people in other places. To us here, they have lost their sense of reality. Everything has lost its shape, its depth, its scent, its color. But all that is left is the amount of time we must suffer before dying.
Yes, the others, the people you know, your friends, this one or that particular one, have all lost their reality. But I speak of the men of the whole world, those who are now and those who will come afterwards. To them, you must render an account.
Why me? One more, one less. Choose someone else for your mission.
We arrive 200. 200 women from all provinces, from all countries of Europe, thrown here into this population of 15,000 women. 15,000 women who are never the same. They arrive by the hundreds each day. They die by the hundreds each day. Of these 15,000 women from all the languages, from all the classes, how many will survive? 15,000 women, 200 women more or less. What difference does it make? You, me, it doesn't matter. None of it matters. There will only matter if there's one who returns.
It won't be me.
Don't you really want to understand anything? Even if you'll pull out for 15 days.
I won't hold out for 15 days because I don't want to. Because I don't believe it matters. Because I prefer to finish it off right away and skip those 15 days.
Suppose you hold out for 15 days during which you will have helped others to hold out. Then 15 days will have been gained and another will take your place and another until there's one who makes it until the end.
Until the end. And when do you see it arriving?
I don't see it any more than you. Even if there is no hope, even if all is lost, you still have to try.
I'm ready to hold out for as long as it takes. Who knows the future? There may be a surprise. Something may happen which would change all the calculations.
The Allies will drop from the sky suddenly, tear out the barbed wire, pull down the watchtowers, and we'll be free. Do you believe in miracles?
Whatever way we get out, getting out will be the miracle.
We have to believe in miracles. Problems have been in every battle, and every shipwreck, there's always one survivor.
Is it a rule? No rules stand here. I know we'll win, but the war will last another 2 years, and I won't last 2 months.
You'll last 2 months if you want to.
No, Claire. Until we came here, I believe that a man, a woman, could be stripped of everything, could lose everything, but still keep her pride. When I joined my resistance group, I thought of torture. I thought of it a lot, so as not to be caught unaware, to get used to resisting it, and I acquired a certain strength, the certainty of resisting torture. Before, I was afraid. I was especially afraid of myself, afraid of weakness. That's why, until we came here, I believe that nothing can divest a human being of its pride. Nothing except dysentery. You can no longer look at yourself and gradually dissolve, turning into dirty water. When diarrhea is dripping from you night and day, without being able to do anything to stop it, to hide yourself, to wash. I am turning into dirty water. My strength is ebbing, stinking. It flows right here, right now, while I stand still, because if I move, it will be worse. My strength and my will are going. It's normal for life to expire from the lips, but when it goes to the intestines, it's complete humiliation.
We've been here for 8 days. We've already lost 10 of our group. What did they die from so quickly?
What their eyes saw made their hearts burst.
The old ones. You're young. You too, Yvonne.
Death will be coming more and more quickly. There are some who no longer have the strength to stand on their feet. Every morning at roll call, they fall. We help them stand up again. Today, tomorrow, we won't have the strength to help them.
You see, Claire, I'm not rambling.
Since you've decided to die, a little sooner or a little later won't matter. Make it a little later for the sake of the one who has to return.
None of us shall return.
How do you know?
I know, and you know just as well.
Visible knowledge isn't necessarily right. I know it's easier to die than to live. You tear your dress lengthways, you twist it up and attach it to a beam of the roof. You jump into the middle of the aisle between the bunks.
Or you bind into the barbed wire. You touch the wire
and electrocuted.
I wouldn't choose that. It's horrible.
Here, there will only horrible versions of death.
And you think you can do that? You aren't free. Even if you are the smallest link, you are part of a chain that links all men, that links them far into the future. No matter what you do, you are a part of the human chain, and you cannot exclude yourself.
Claire's right. If there is only one chance to get out of here, and for only one of us, we must force that chance and help the one among us who will have it. There must be one who returns.
You're lucky, Claire, and you too, Ren, to always know what ought to be done.
My name is Marie. I'm 16. Can I come with you? Can you take me with you? Because I'm all alone now.
Did you arrive all alone?
No, my parents. My father, my mother, my grandmother, the little ones, my little brother, my little sister, in a big transport.
Where did you come from?
Paris.
You haven't been here very long.
Oh, yes, 10 days. Years of single season, years of winter and of night. It was a big transport. Most of the whole train went to the gas. There were many old men and many children. My parents weren't old, but didn't want to leave grandmother and the little ones. Me, I wanted to stay in the same column. They said it was the common for the health camp, special camp for the aged and for the children. The officer took me out from the other column, a very small column. The only person I knew there was a girl of my own age who had traveled in the same freight car. Her parents had to take him too, so we stayed together until this morning.
What did she die of?
I don't know. Her face was all swollen, all red this morning. She was dead at my side.
You can stay with Denise and her sister. They have a box at the end with five other little ones. They'll make room for you. Denise! Monique! Would you take this little one with you? She's all alone. Her name is Marie. She's 16, like you.
She was beautiful, my little sister. I can't imagine how beautiful she was. They couldn't have looked at her. If they had looked at her, they wouldn't have killed her. They wouldn't have been able to.
She's striking her on the head, on the chest, on the eyes. Oh, Claire's furious. She's giving it back to the capo blow for blow, with her fists, with her feet, but the other one won't stop either. I can't believe Claire is so strong. There's another one coming. Claire is on the ground. The two furies are trampling her. It's Claire. They've smashed her skull. Now they're leaving. It's finished.
We must go and get Claire.
They're giving the order to pick her up, to put her back in her place.
Do not let me become evil in this place.
Claire dies for me. The Furies would have left me alive if Claire hadn't diverted their blows.
All those who died here died for the others. You could say death must take its toll. It attacks the group. If the group is large enough, some will be left. But the number keeps diminishing. The screen that the others form between death and each of us tears more each day. And soon, there will be nothing between us and death.
And soon it will be our turn. My turn.
You mustn't say.
Words become irrevocable when they're pronounced. It's only through blindness that we can hope. It is not courage we need. It's blindness, or madness. Our only chance is for East to say to herself, if there is one who returns, it must be I. And it's madness to say that to yourself. And then knows why she must return.
Oh yes, Agnes, to tell how the others died.
Do you have a significant reason?
The only one.
If there is one who returns, I don't want to be hurt. What can she do, that one who returns, to start life again? Do you think to start again, Gina?
I don't know, but if you think of the resources within ourselves and each other that we find to draw upon to come out alive, you realize we will find other resources to live again if we return.
No, Gina, we left all our energy here. Nothing will remain. If we return, we live without life.
She's breaking rank.
You called her. Why?
Hush, Gina. We're all thinking it.
Her feet are swollen, enormous. It must be because of that. It's for Block 25.
Block 25 is the prison within the prison. Those who can only walk, those who don't die quickly enough within our ranks, are locked up there. They have almost nothing to eat, nothing to drink. The yard of Block 25 is Alden. And our box has a window pane which looks out into the yard. We see. The yard is covered with bodies. Every second or third day, a truck empties Block 25 to make more room. Those who are not dead yet are taken to be gassed. Two prisoners, strong ones, they are chosen by their build and they are fed both for that work. Grab them by the waist or by the arms and throw them onto the truck. They work fast and well. They are watched. Why do they do that work? They are called the Heaven Commando. They know that they have 3 months reprieve, and after that, they in turn will be gassed. Why do they accept that work? Because 3 months here is a long time. It's as long as all the future. No one here can see more than 3 weeks ahead, and they are assured of 3 months. They say to themselves that in 3 months, the war will be over, that they will be free. But how will they live after having done that work? I wonder if they don't wonder. I wouldn't do that. How dearly a man must cling to life to accept that work. How dearly a woman must cling to life to kill Claire. How dearly I must cling to life to see it happen and stay there without moving. But here, no one clings to life. It's life that clings to us. We saw some of them leaving on the truck. There are some who cry out, and the cries do not come from human throats. Most don't cry out. They don't have the strength anymore. You would think that they had given up if you did not see their eyes. You've never seen such terror in the eyes. Whom did they take?
Someone, I don't know, a young one. I think it's one of the peasant girls. The group came from the next group, from the Polish woman.
Comrades! I give you my son!
carry her birds back to the world.
I cried so much when they shot my husband. Today I envy him. At least he died a clean death.
You're strong, Gina. You'll return.
You too, Francois. You're stronger than you think.
We're all stronger than you think. Even before we were arrested. Who would have thought that a little secretary like Nunette would leave her typewriter, her shopping trips, her hairdresser, and her appointments with her boyfriend under the opera clock to carry grenades, to throw them into a window of a cafe full of enemy soldiers. That Yvonne would leave her parents, the high school where she taught Greek, to join a band of snipers. That Marie Therese would give her children to a nursemaid to devote herself completely to the fight. For months on end, they lived in shadows among shadows without eating on time, or when they were hungry, without any support. But that of their comrades whom they met secretly in a subway platform, or in some badly lit station to make liaisons, to carry papers, carry plans, carry orders, carry explosives. Who would have said that Marguerite would leave her farm to join the partisans?
Or that I, whose day was spoiled by a run in my stocking, would take an oath to get out of here.
No one expected that. Nunette, Yvonne, Marie Therese chose to be ready for anything. We were all ready for anything. Without imagining what awaited us, because it was unimaginable, we were protected against surprise.
And indeed, it is not surprise that strikes us down. It's not from that horror beyond measure that we are dying. There were some who, at the start, had their throats so constricted that they could not swallow, who had their eyes opened so wide with horror that they could not close them, and who died having neither eaten nor slept. We are dying of cold, of fatigue, of dysentery, of fever. And what defense do we have against cold, against contagion, against filth, against thirst, against lice, against hunger, against fatigue? That overwhelming fatigue.
We are fighters. We must fight. Here, we fight against death.
With bare hands, with bare hearts, with bare skin. From where can we draw strength?
We must not give in. I want to return. I swear I will. And if I do not return, hear me well, Francoise. If I do not return, you'll tell my father, and no time did I give in. At no moments, I will never give in.
You'll never give in? I wish I could say that.
How can you say that?
You can't give them the thing that they want.
By deciding that we will return, we're defying them. Harden yourself, Francoise. We cannot permit them to triumph over our corpses. They will have many, but they must not have all. Those who return will have one. I don't like to lose. I'll win.
You'll win what?
It does not matter what. You're in a battle. It's hand-to-hand combat. You do not want the enemy to win.
It isn't there that we will prevent them.
No, unfortunately.
The real battle is not taking place here. It's taking place in the woods, in Stalingrad, in London, in Athens, in Belgrade, in Paris, in Warsaw. Those who are fighting outside are fighting for us. But were they not to see us again? Their victory would taste of defeat. They would have the feeling they had fought for nothing.
No, not for nothing. For freedom as we fought.
We wanted more than freedom, more than a graveyard.
It will be so vast, this graveyard. It won't be space for the survivors.
The children who will be born will make room for themselves, so not worry.
For whose children? All the husbands, all the lovers, all the fiancés have been shot.
All humanity will not perish here. There will still be children. I want to return to tell them.
You will return, Gina.
I'd like to be sure of it. I need to talk myself into it. If you lose sight of your return, you're lost. And I believe it in spite of everything. But if you return without me, tell my father the truth. Don't hide anything. You'll have to tell the truth, even to the mothers.
Would you be able to tell Claire's mother how she died?
I will do it. I will, because it has to be done. Because it is in the order that the truth be known, that we want to return. We will have the strength to live it. Why would the others not have the strength to hear it?
I wonder if we will have the strength to tell it, and they won't believe us. They'll think that since we have returned, it is not as terrible as we say. By returning, we will deny our own story.
Thank you. theirs.
What is it?
Who is it? One who can't take it anymore? One who's dying? Another one? How many will remain? How many of us will remain?
None. It's not possible.
You're not sleeping yet?
We're going right to sleep. The nights are so short and we waste them chatting.
Talking is as important as sleeping. It helps as much. If I did not talk, it would seem to me as if I was no longer alive. I say anything, we say anything, but we never speak of more than one thing.
Oh, no, we make plans too. If I return, I'll open a tea shop. The cakes will be exquisite, especially the eclairs, and I'll make a chocolate that will be the sensation of Paris. Paris has never known one like it, creamy, thick, with a touch of coffee. Have you ever had coffee-flavored chocolate? You make a real coffee extract, a really strong coffee, and you put a drop in the chocolate. It's delicious. It gives it this tiny bitterness which really enhances the flavor of the chocolate.
With chocolate, I like toast. Very crusty, crunchy, and in the middle it's soft. Soaked in warm butter, put on the hot toast, and that spreads while melting. You think it's someone dying?
Who's dying? Do you think it's one of us?
Shh! Quiet!
We heard that they were in Paris. My husband went to get some men, Brooks, my brother's. He's a builder in St. Martin. It's a mile away, so I took a cart. I was in the garden. I was gathering chives for the salad when I saw him come back. Put the cart away and start mixing cement. What are you doing? You're playing at this hour. It's lunchtime. Pay no attention, he told me, and he went down to the cellar with his hot. He came up for a quick snack, and he sent me to call our nephew to help me dry your breast down. In the evening, my Stephen came up with a bottle. I chose one of the best, left over from the kids' communion. It's the last thing we'll drink until the end of the war. We invited the neighbors. It was our own white wine. We have this little vineyard not far from our house. There are years for which it's famous. Touraine wine is not for Prussians to drink, he said. My husband had walled up the cellar. Lovely work he did. Really, you wouldn't suspect a thing. He even made water stains, but when would we return to drink it? Never.
How can you say that, Elizabeth?
Look at my legs. I press down on them, and the indentation remains all white. The swollen legs have only got 3 days to go.
And mine? Are they swollen?
What is it?
A prisoner going toward the electrical barbed wire to end it all. With the spotlights covering the camp, the guards always see them first. Attempt to escape, they say.
Why do legs swap so fast? At night, there's nothing, and the next day
is the heart.
Do you think we'll drink any Getty Pot? Some of that Touraine wine?
None of us will ever drink the wine of Touraine.
I'm afraid to sleep because I'm afraid to dream. Night is more frightening than day because at night, as soon as I fall asleep, I'm alone. During the day, I talk. Gina, Francois, or someone answers. And in my dreams, no one answers. I'm always alone and I'm afraid. While I'm falling asleep, I already know what I will dream. I'm afraid. If we've carried bricks during the day, I carry bricks and they are colder against my breasts, heavier to my hands than during the day. Frozen bricks. In our house, mother used to give us a warm brick in winter to heat our bed. I burned my sheet once. There was a smell of burning in the bed. Mother scolded me. At night, bricks are covered with ice. Ice which cuts even more deeply than during the day, and the skin on the inside of my hands is burnt by the ice. I still carry bricks on an interminable road, and the bricks are heavier and heavier, colder and colder. During the day, while carrying the bricks, we chat. Gina tells us great restaurants where she used to eat with her husband and her friends. She would put on a dinner dress, black, with just one jewel. She must have been elegant, Gina. She must have been beautiful, all dressed up with her hair done. Francoise tells about her tricks. At night, there are just the bricks, and when it's not the bricks, it's the dogs. I try to make detours, but she, I figure out how to get away from the dogs, but they leap far and in one single jump cover the entire distance that I've succeeded in putting between them and me. They throw themselves on me. They're enormous dogs, and I feel their warm and repugnant breath. They're panting on my face. I'm petrified with fear. It's impossible to escape from those dirty beasts. Their breath on my cheek is so strong that it awakens me, and then I understand that it's the breathing of Renee or Agnes who sleep next to me. I reassure myself, and I tell myself that I have to go back to sleep. Otherwise, I won't make it through the next day. But I'm afraid. I'm afraid that this time it'll be the mud, the black mud, sticky and icy when the ice melts as the day progresses and the swamp turns into muck, a lake of mire that extends as far as the other end of the horizon. I swirl in the mud. I go in deeper and deeper, and I can't get hold anywhere. There's nothing to hold on to. I'm afraid to have it in my mouth. I want to cry out for help. I hold myself back. I close my mouth tightly because the mud is at level with my lips. I'm too scared. I scream. The mud goes down my throat, through my mouth and my nostrils, fills my stomach with a stinking gurgling, and suffocates me. Probably, I really screamed. My neighbor shakes me awake. The most atrocious dream is the one when I come home. My mother is doing dishes where she's ironing. Come close. Mother, it's me. You see? I've come back. Oh, Mother, I still don't believe it. I was so afraid that I wouldn't come back, but it's true. This time, it's true. Mother doesn't turn her head towards me. It was hard, you know, Mother. She continues her washing or her ironing. She doesn't hear me. She doesn't turn towards me. Mother, it's me, your Mounette. If you knew, Mother, how many times I dreamt that I was coming back. But this time it's true. It's true. It's true because I'm touching you. I'm touching your hand. Your hand is a little rough, a little hard. You should wear gloves when you do dishes. Happiness flows through me to the tips of my fingers. I feel warm and sweet all over. And then I awake with Renee's or Agnes's hand in mine. It's the dream that frightens me most. At night, you're afraid. In the morning, you want to die.
She's in the snow forever. No, they're going to take her away and put her on the pile. Oh, Deanie, my little one.
Don't think about it, Bear. Don't think about it like that. Think about the way she was before.
How can I go back without Deanie? How do you want me to do it? My father will never understand.
Yes, he will. He will understand as long as you let yourself return. We will go with you to tell him. Let him at least find one of you again.
Deanie was my little sister. She was my daughter, my child. I brought her up. I was the big sister and the little mother. I brought her up. I was 10 when our mother died giving birth to her. She was strong though, Deanie. She wanted to return with all her heart. At 20, she cheered me when I weakened. If only you knew how cheerful she was, even in prison before we left. She knew 1,000 songs. You could hear her voice all over Montluc. And last night she said to me, "Don't leave me, Bear. I need to know you're next to me. Put your hand in my heart. Do you feel it beating?" "Yes, Deanie, I feel it. It's beating strong." Then she didn't speak anymore. Her mouth was all dried out. I kept some tea. I dipped my fingers into the mug and I wet her lips and her gums. She couldn't swallow anymore. Her throat was swollen. I passed my wet fingers over her lips and I felt her lips grow cold during the night. And now I've left her.
Cry, Bettine, try to cry. The dead should not be deprived of our tears. Cry, even if the tears freeze on your cheeks and you can't feel their sobs. Cry. It will help pull yourself together. You must help us now. We need you.
No one needs me anymore.
Yes, we do. Your father will later.
What will I tell my father? Here I am, but Deanie stayed behind. She was taken for a work team. She spent all day under the hail and melting snow. She was soaked in her dress, never dried again. And I couldn't change dresses with her. Mine was soaked too. And she ran a fever for 3 days. I knew what she had. I heard the whistling in her chest. I had nothing to care for her with. Nothing but my hands to rub her, my breath to warm her, my arm to make her walk to work in spite of everything, to make her stand in spite of everything at roll call. She ran a fever for 3 days and she's dead. Pneumonia. Why her? Why her and not me?
You won't leave me, Nizu, my little darling. I won't let you leave me.
No, Monique. No, Niket. I'll never leave you. We were taken together. We'll return together.
Be brave, Bertin.
Why brave? How can I live without Deanie after having abandoned her in the snow in the night?
Hold on, Bear. Hold on for another hour, another minute. It's not from day to day that you have to hold on. It's from minute to minute, 1 minute at a time. Don't give up.
That's why the days are so long. All these minutes, one by one, these minutes, one at a time. Have you ever observed a moment of silence at a ceremony? A minute is long. First you think of the person you are honoring, then you think of lots of things. I have to buy nail polish. I have to go to the bookstore. My order must be ready. I have to call Susie. And when the chairman looks at his watch and you sit down again, you're relieved, as if you've been standing for a long time. Here, each day is broken down into all its minutes. And during each of these minutes, you have to be on the alert, without any respite, the size of a blow and not to fall, to force yourself to move your toes and your claws or the freeze, to keep your head, to keep your memory. I'm most afraid to lose my memory, my certainty that I am still myself. We must remain on the alert, to stay conscious of ourselves and order our hearts to keep beating. But in vain, my heart no longer obeys my command. Dysentery also drains the blood. If only there were some water to wash. I tried with snow. Snow isn't good for washing, and it's icy on the belly. I gave up trying. I don't care anymore.
What don't you care about, Yvonne?
Whether I die now, this morning, right away?
Yes, right away. Right away, no one would care. Since it isn't right away, you have to hold on. And what of the others? Look at Bert. She's more unhappy than any of us.
She'll force herself to overcome her pain because she has courage and she'll suffer longer for it.
You're exhausted, Yvonne. Don't talk anymore. With daybreak, you'll find yourself again. And you'll tell me about the Acropolis and what you see from there.
Finding yourself is an illusion, a trick. I need not find myself because I am not lost. Only my body is losing life. I've become myself and another at the same time. Another is detached, clairvoyant, gifted with a sharpened sense of observation, who looks at the first me who is disappearing. I look at my body disappearing and I don't care. I only wish it didn't take so long. All that I'm dreading is dragging on. It takes so long to die of exhaustion. Hopefully when I'm a little more worn out, my mind will grow dark, but I won't see myself anymore.
You're logical, Yvonne. It's frightening how logical you are. No one can answer you back.
You have to pray for her.
Pray for us all, that the good Lord prepare himself to receive us one after the other.
Oh, Mother, do you think that God hears our prayers from here?
Yes, my daughter. God hears everything, especially the call of those who are suffering.
God is deaf, blind, and serene in its egotistical perfection.
So be blessed, Miss Helene, my darling.
God forgive her.
Let your mother pray, Helene. Her praying is one more moment blind.
I don't believe in God anymore, and for the time that...
Don't try to slip through my fingers, little one. I'll hold you tight. Marie! Marie! Marie, do you hear me?
Yes, Mother, I hear you.
Then come back.
Yes, Mother, what were you telling me?
I was telling you, courage. Up! Don't let yourself fall into the snow. It's cold.
No, the snow is soft. It is like a great coat. I'm so cold. Cold all through me. Let me lie down.
No. Skip. Up. Up.
Day is breaking, you see? The sky is becoming light. Look. Look up at the sky. Those great red patches that are starting to set the sky on fire.
It's colder than it was just a little while ago.
Put your hands over your mouth and blow your breath up to your nose like this. It warms you to have the tip of your nose less cold. Try. You'll see.
Make a place for me in the front. I want to see.
What is there to see?
As soon as day breaks, they take the dead out of the sick bay and carry them to the morgue. You knew that wooden hut behind block 25? That's where they piled them up to wait for the truck for the crematorium. I want to see if they carry out my mother. She went to the sick bay the other day.
What will it do for you to see her pass?
Don't be so hard, Ren.
I have to know the date of her death. What date is today?
20th. The 20th of February.
You won't recognize her under that little cover.
The legs stick out. My mother has deformed feet. I would recognize her feet.
There's the funeral procession advancing. The funeral procession of those who've died during the night on the little stretchers of poorly attached branches too short for the bodies, with the blanket that covers the middle in shreds. The legs stick out between the front handles. The shaved heads hang between the back. You don't see the faces, and upside down rattling between the ends of the branches. The legs are enough. The skeleton's legs which hang between the branches. And every morning I want to die. But when I see those stretchers passing, I don't want to anymore. I don't want to go out that way with my head hanging and my legs dangling. Don't look, Yvonne. Why are you looking?
Today it's them. Tomorrow us.
There's a lot of them today. Young ones.
How can you tell?
By their tender feet. They didn't last very long here. The skin of their feet is still soft.
I would rather die outside than in the sick bay. No, not the sick bay. Better standing up.
Me, no. I prefer lying down.
You don't want to go to the sick bay?
Yes, in a moment I'll join the column for the sick. Did I here or there, better there? I can't stand up any longer.
Stay with us, Yvonne. Stay another day. Tomorrow maybe you'll be better.
You're sweet, Francoise, but I know what lies ahead.
It's true that you go feet first. It's always in that direction that they carry them.
My God, grant that this day does not separate my Helene and me. We cannot be harder than yesterday. Grant us that we both lived through it.
It wasn't too long today. Monday they rush it. They're hung over on Mondays.
Today's not Monday, it's Wednesday.
No, it's Monday. I'd love to have a hangover and have every hair on my head hurt. If we had hair, we'd feel less cold. It's the temples that ache. I feel as if my head were in a big nutcracker and my skull is splitting apart.
They're calling for the sick bay. Goodbye, everybody.
Yvonne!
Renee?
Stay here, Marie. You hear me? You wanted to come with us? You will stay with us!
Please let me go. I can't take it anymore. If I could just lie down, I think my strength would come back.
Strength doesn't come back when you're lying down. On the contrary, the bed weakens you, especially that bed.
Strength is in your mind. Be strong, Marie. You have to return. You too.
No one is waiting for me. I'll have no one at home anymore. Let me go, please.
Let her go, Renee. There are some who come out of sick bay. They come out feet first. Mind your business, Mounette. Don't you know that in the sick bay you catch all kinds of diseases? You're with the dying ones, with the delirious ones, with the stinking ones, with the ones burning up one day and frozen the next, right next to you. And that makes you cold. Marie can still hold out. Can't you, Marie? Maybe tomorrow it will thaw a bit.
And me? You would prevent me from going to sick bay?
Think of your mother, Mounette.
Oh, my mother. I don't see her anymore. Tonight I dreamed that I returned home and that my mother didn't look at me. Or rather, I didn't recognize her face.
Our mothers, too, must have changed since we left, since they don't know where we are.
It's not that I didn't recognize her face. It's more like I didn't see it. Or rather, no, I did see a shape. I knew it was my mother. I squinted. I wanted to see her face. I tried until my eyelids ached. I didn't see her. My mother's face is disappearing.
A mother's face doesn't disappear ever. And since when were you so upset by a dream? As if there weren't enough in each day to upset us already.
I've lost my mother's face.
Stop saying stupid things, Mounette. You had more spirit before. You were supporting Yvonne, and now you're just letting yourself go.
Yvonne was courageous, and you see...
What did Mounette say?
Stupid things. That she lost her mother's face during the night.
It's a bad dream of the day what you raised. Look at the daybreak, Mounette. Another day. One more day. A day so long, especially when you're not sure to see it through.
We made it to the end of the other so far.
My strength decreases at each new dawn. Till now, I was sure to see Mother again. Since last night, I know that I won't see her.
Be reasonable, Mounette. It'll be much worse if you could see your mother, if she were here with you. Look at Helene, who's with her mother. Each one suffering doubly for herself and for the other. For the mother, it's worse yet because a mother always thinks she can protect her child, and here, she can't do anything. She sees her daughter beaten, and she lowers her head. And for the daughter, to see her mother beaten, naked, tattooed, shaven, dirty, then one soon thinks that they are a burden to the other. Look at Sylvie, who really lost her mother, who's looking among the dead who feet dangle on little stretchers. Next to them, you're lucky. Think of your mother to give you courage, Mounette, to give you confidence. Think of her in real life, not the hallucinations of the night. I think of my son. If only he can think of me as I think of him at each second, he would never forget my face, but he was too young when I left him.
How old is he?
6. He's been going to school since the fall. My mother-in-law told me the last letter I got before we left the prison. When I see the children arrive here to go into the gas chambers.
Or not to be thrown alive into the fire.
What are you talking about, Elizabeth?
They came upon an idea to make more room in the gas chambers. They take the children, they undress them, and they throw them in an enormous ditch, set fire to it. The children don't struggle.
How do you know that?
Last night, I talked to the girl who works for the children's commando. You saw it. It's the one that comes back after the others late at night. They're cleanly dressed. They're called the White Kerchiefs. There's a girl there. She speaks French rather well. She lived in Paris before the war.
Keep your news to yourself, Elizabeth. Don't you think we know enough?
Regina, we must know everything.
When I see the children here, I tell myself that I'll never love my son enough. I have to love him for all the little ones here.
Don't get soft, Agnes. It hurts.
Francoise,
who's looking for me?
Me, Lena. I have a secret to tell you.
There are no secrets here. There were only lost secrets, my poor Lena.
Yes, but listen, I was...
Who is that? Is she from our group?
Isn't it Laura?
I just came back. I left because a nurse told me to get out, no matter what. There must be a selection for the gas chambers.
It'll be gone. What are we going to do? What can we do with her? She can't walk. Laura? What are we going to do?
Laura! Laura! What can we do, Laura? Laura! What are we going to do, Laura? Laura's dead. We have to leave her. Thank you.
that would be for demolition work. So much the better. Maybe we'll be inside for the soup. Stand straight, Marie. If we find a dry corner to sit during the break, we'll ask Francoise to take us to the theater. What woman will we ask her for? She does all the voices and knows all the stories. You would think you were hearing the actors.
Possible to last so long of a time. 70 days, and now we no longer means the same thing.
70 days, and now we is Gina, Francoise, and myself. My sister is dead. The others are dead. All of them, all of the others, dead before our eyes, like Juliet from Borador who fell one morning, under our eyes by the swamps. How did she manage to walk there that morning? It's because when she arrived here, she took such a strong vow to hold out at any cost, at any price, that her will held up until she fell. Under our eyes by the swamps. She lay there until night when we had to carry her back to the camp. I think that's the only time we looked forward to seeing the watchtowers at the fork in the road. The only time we were encouraged when we smelled the odor of the camp. It's extraordinary how far the odor spreads. It's an odor that there are many things I didn't know, like how cadavers are soft and easy to manipulate. She was heavy, so heavy, Juliet, with nothing left of her at the end of her life, emaciated in a way that we had never seen before. Those who carried her were at the end of their lives, too. Then there was one who was bitten by a dog. She was on the outside row, preparing to leave the row. We gather dandelions on the side of the road each time we can. Stealthily, you must be quick. It's forbidden. But since everything's forbidden, she was on the outside row, preparing to leave the row, already bent over. But she didn't look around carefully enough. A dog jumped her and sunk its fangs into her throat. She let out a cry, a single brief cry. It drug her like that to the edge of the swamp, and it even dropped her on the road and then picked her up in its mouth again. That time she didn't cry. She laid on the edge of the swamp where she panted for many hours at long intervals, and at every interval, we hoped it was over. We had to carry her back at night, too. And it was unbearable to look at that throat. We would tell ourselves, look at where you're putting your feet. Look far away. We're almost all used to looking far away since we've been here. Far away in space, of course, in time. Not 70 days. We kept a track of the days so as that we didn't feel a break in between what we were before and what we have become. But there's no mistake. 70 days. And now it's spring. The spring of this place. Here, spring is not shown by trees or leaves. There are none in camp. The snow melted and the mud has replaced it. Mud is worse than the snow. We lose our clogs, which get stuck in it. We have to go in with two hands to pull them out, and the mud retains odors. It smells of diarrhea. But with the coming of spring, it's less cold. Oh, that's one way of putting things. When we go outside for roll call, we stand for hours on end. I say hours because they are real hours, not minutes that seem like hours to us. From 3 in the morning until 7 in the morning, that's really hours. Standing for hours motionless with an icy rain pelting us or a cold wind lashing at us. Then the spring came to the swamps. The swamps melted so that we don't carry clods of frozen earth. We carry the wet earth. And at lunch, we can wash ourselves. It's the only water you have, so we mustn't drink it. It smells rotten. There are those who did drink it, but they're dead.
There are those who will ask, but what did they die from, all of them? All of them didn't drink the water. All of them weren't strangled by dogs. And all of them weren't beaten to death the way Claire was. Well, it's true. There are those who died of thirst, like little Aurora. Her lips were all chapped. She had no more saliva in her mouth, so she couldn't speak. Her eyes had grown bigger than her face. She had mauve eyes, yes, mauve. And with thirst, they became discolored, like her lips, which were no more than torn pieces of gray skin. I don't know when or where she died. In any case, she wouldn't have been able to say anything. Her lips wanted her to speak, but no sound came out. But the others, all of them, all of the others, they died of the life here. Why them and not I? I don't know. There are so many questions without answers that are impossible to know. I was neither among the strongest nor among the bravest of the young ones. Of those who were less than 20, I am the only one left. I don't know anything anymore. The only thing that I know is that my sister died in the sick bay. She went in when the boils on her legs became infected. We didn't have a piece of rag or a drop of water. The swamps were still iced over. At night after roll call, I sometimes succeeded in slipping over to the sick bay to see her. But when I had told Gina that a rat had eaten Monique's ear, and that Monique wasn't even dead, Gina forbade me to ever go see her again. Tell me, Gina, why did you forbid me to go see Monique? Do you think that she lingered on with those rats that she no longer had the strength to brush away? The last time I saw her, she couldn't even raise her hand to place it in mine.
Stop taking the roll call of the dead. You have to defend yourself from the dead. You must wait until we're back home to remember.
Do you think that I can wait for another tomorrow without thinking once of my sister?
You have to, or give up thinking about her forever.
Do you think that I can postpone what comes into my head?
You have to, or give up any hope of living.
You've become hard, Gina.
Hard? We will have to keep on being that way for a long time.
How will we live afterwards if we come back so hardened?
I think of that too. But I tell myself, if I could cry on my mother's shoulder, tenderness and weakness and pity will come back to me.
You have a mother. Me and my
father. If we come back, I'll share my mother with you.
All of our sentences start with, if we come back.
We must say, when we come back.
What will we do when we come back? I see myself coming back. Well, there are days when I see myself coming back, but I can't see beyond that.
I can't see myself getting back into the routines of before.
It will be easy if we could find what we left. If we could just take up where we left off, like when you come home from a long trip. But my home will be missing my husband. And no, I don't know what I'll do, but we mustn't think about it. Let's return first and we'll see.
I can't see myself for the rest of my life without my husband.
And yet, we weren't married very long. Me 3 years, you 4. For me, it's as if I never lived before my marriage. Everything begins with Henry, but here we never evoke anything but our childhoods. I never think of Henry, and you of Paul?
No, never. But I know why. It's because it's too painful to remember love and happiness here, and to know that they'll never be found again. We assume the task of us to preserve our energy, of thinking only of our childhood years, which are past, when everything was simple and unshadowed. It is in the order of things that they should pass. I think of my mother.
So do I. And I even very often forget that she's dead. She died when Monique and I were in prison last summer. Last summer. We could say a century ago, a world ago, or a life ago.
But you, Denise, you'll take up again quickly, you'll see. Your life hasn't started yet. When you come back, you'll begin life. You left as a child, and you'll return grown up.
No, Gina, it will be much harder for me than for you. When you were arrested, you knew I was going to school.
able to go back. I'd be old next to the other schoolgirls, and I'll miss what I haven't learned in school for the rest of my life.
But you can study in other ways. There are books.
I say that the way people say things, without weighing what they say.
Will we be able to get interested in stories and books? We'll have to learn to live all over again if we come back.
When we come back.
To stay motionless alone, sitting with a book. I wonder.
You know, Francoise, I told myself often, if we come back, when we come back, I'll read all of the books Francoise told me about.
But it's not enough to read books. You have to do something to earn a living.
Earn a living. It's strange to say that here. I don't know what I'll do, what I can do. I have no idea. I envy you. At the worst moments, when all of our comrades were falling, when several fell each day, I envied you. Gina and Francoise, I thought. If they die now, they will have lived. They will have had something. They went to the theater. They were married. They were loved. They loved. I will have had nothing.
When you come back, you'll start to live. Ruth, we'll have trouble starting anew.
And everything you've learned since...
Do you think that what we've learned here is useful in life?
Everything a person knows is useful.
You think so, Gina? What use is there in knowing how to read death sitting on a face at the very minute when it pinches the nostrils, clings to the cheekbones, and tints the eyelids purple? In life, those who are going to die are in a hospital or at home in a room with little bottles on a night table. Flowers, tea, a slice of lemon that floats on top. What use is it ever to read truth in a face? In life, who needs to see through people? To know in one split second if they'll share their bread or help others to walk? This is a gift we have acquired here, which we'll have to get rid of because it will be terrible to see everything in that light. Here, everything is true, in a hard way, without shadows. The executioners are executioners. They have the costumes, marks, the traits. They don't try to conceal it to pass for human beings. They are executioners without hypocrisy. They never try to flatter, they never try to fake a smile. They don't see us, although we see them and how different they are from us. And the victims are victims, brutalized, defeated, humiliated, disgusting, lice-ridden. And those among the victims who succeed in crossing over to the other side, they immediately take on the badges that distinguish their new office, armbands, sticks, or whips, and the faces to go with them. We have seen, side by side, the worst cruelty and the greatest beauty. I mean, those who practically carried me in their arms when I couldn't walk, those who gave me their tea when I was choking from thirst, when my tongue was like a piece of rough wood in my mouth, those who touched my hand and managed to form a smile on their chapped lips when I was desperate, those who picked me up when I fell in the mud when they were so weak themselves, those who took my feet in their hands when we were going tonight to sleep, and who blew on them when I had felt they had begun to freeze. And here I am. They all died for me. No one dies for anyone else in life.
All the same, we've learned something from them. Courage. The simplicity of courage.
You don't need so much courage in life. You don't need that kind of courage.
Life will be much harder for us after. We've gotten into the habit of showing our naked faces. Can you go without a mask in life? Can you learn to take the mask off others? Others will turn away so as not to let us see the faces that only our eyes discern. They'll be afraid of us. And what will we say to them? To those who will never understand that we're unlike anyone else, different even from them. What can we do to be as if we had never been here?
We'll have to find a way to get along, to readjust.
The gap will be too big, Gina. I don't see how it's possible.
We'll explain and no one will understand. We'll never be able to make them see what we have seen. We'll bore people the way that those from the First World War bored us. They never stopped talking about Verdun and we didn't understand.
That's because there was nothing in their lives except for the moment when they were at one with history. It's not so for us. We won't have fought just to come back, just to survive. We won't live without knowing why. When we come back, we'll do something.
You forget all the ones, all that we saw.
If we do something when we come back, something exciting, something exalting, those moments will go on and will become a memory. And they'll go on to be a single moment, but not the only moment.
What will be exciting to us afterwards? I think often of what Agnes has said. We will have left our energy here, our desire to live.
No, Francoise, the desire to live would have already left us. Were we going to lose it here?
Here, that's easy. I don't know.
Maybe we fight here because the fight is superhuman, excessive, it's a challenge. There is no other goal, to survive, to get back. When there is no longer a challenge, what will we live for?
It will be worthwhile if only to communicate this knowledge we've gained.
It's an incommunicable knowledge, as Francois said, useless.
With our comrades dead, we should say we're lucky to have lasted so long.
It isn't over. The moment hasn't come to walk through the gates for the last time.
In any case, you can be sure I won't look back that time.
What if all those will leave behind?
We won't leave them. We'll take them with us in us.
You mean, Gina, that we won't ever forget them? There are some of them whose names I didn't even know.
Even without a name, they'll still be in us. We'll restore them with a look or a gesture, maybe in our dreams.
If I have to return to relive all of this in my dreams,
oh no. Don't be afraid, Denise. Dreams fade.
Me? I'm not afraid to dream. I'll touch my sheets fine and crispy in my nightgown. I love crepe de chine nightgowns. They're like another skin softer than your own. I'll caress my sheets and I'll know that I'm dreaming.
You see, you'll be able to live again. You have had so many things that you love.
You'll have them, Denise. Just to get undressed to go to sleep in a bed with sheets, with slippers when you get off the bed, that alone.
70 days during which we haven't taken our dresses off. They must stink, but we don't notice because our nostrils are full of the smell of the crematorium. If we could smell
it. Oh, and perfume. It's so nice. It's something that you touch and that you don't touch. Opaque and transparent, real and unreal. I love perfume.
You see, you'll be able to live again. I don't know anything about perfumes. My mother never bought any. She never bought much of anything.
Yes, Denise, you will have everything to love.
What is that woman from us? It looks as though she's calling us. And me, the three, she's signaling you, Gina.
All right, I'm going.
What can she have to do with Gina? Do you know her, the big capo?
By sight, it's the capo of the white kerchiefs.
What can she have to do with Gina?
It looks as if Gina's arguing with her.
What did she want?
Oh, to ask if I knew some Lydia, French girl.
The chestnut trees must be in bloom now in Paris.
From my window, I used to see the Butte Chaumont. I think it was the most beautiful park in Paris.
I don't know the place. It's not my neighborhood. I'd go to the Luxembourg, sit on a bench with a book and the noise of the water in the basin of the fountain.
At home, we used to walk along the mall. It's this green walk with a lot of plane trees. They're really beautiful, especially in the spring, when the leaves are like fine lace. They get their leaves much later than the chestnut trees. We had the chestnut trees in the schoolyard. We have privileges now that we've been here for a long time. 2 inches of hair gets us as much respect as a venerable beard. We know how to escape from the clippers and the disinfection. You remember the last time when we stood outside from morning roll call until evening roll call. How cold it was. And it was Renee who said, cabbage soup, margarine, or naked women. I don't want to see any of them ever again for the rest of my life. She was funny, Renee. That day, we had less hope of getting out of here than today. Just because we were not so cold.
Spring without the taste of spring. How I'd like to have a taste in my mouth.
After roll call, I saw a Russian woman in the garden selling onions. 2 onions for a ration of bread. I had already exchanged my ration of bread for a pair of underpants, the way you told me. If I had known, I would have waited until tomorrow for the underpants.
I'd like to bite into an onion. But when I think of a taste, I mean something good, really good, a fruit,
or a fish. Gina, give us your recipe for Solan whiskey. I like Solan whiskey the way you make it. I don't know how whiskey is, I've never had any, but you cut the fillets.
Another time, it's late, you have to sleep.
Okay, well, good night.
What did she want?
I have to join her commando.
But that's impossible. You told her that you didn't want to, that you couldn't.
She took my number.
My name's already on her list.
The white kerchief, Commando?
Yes.
What can you do? What can we do?
What is there to do?
I can't do what she asks in any case.
To undress children, to throw them into a ditch full of kindling wood that they set fire to? Never. To undress the children and fold their little clothes into mere square piles while they burn? No.
What can you do?
There's always an option. We've often talked about it together.
But Gina, you argued. You told her that you didn't want to.
It's useless, Francoise. You know I tried. What are you going to do? When it's completely dark, I'll go towards the barbed wire.
I'm going with you.
No. You must stay with her.
What will I tell her?
You'll explain. Just wait as long as possible.
As long as possible. But that'll be in a little while when she gets up at the cypher, and you won't be next to us. I want to talk to you. It seems to me that I have so much to tell you before we part.
Words are lost, and the one is going to die. It should be me that talks to you, but let's admit that we've told each other everything in these days and nights we spent together escaping past into resolution. Our husbands could still write a name on the wall, so they spent their last nights before Mont Valerian, but I'll only write on your memory.
Memory is fragile here.
You'll hold out. The worst is over. Do you remember what I told you for my father?
I remember. I will remember. I'll try to carry back your memory, but I'll do everything I can. I give you my word.
It's the darkest part of the night. I'm going.
You still have time before the siren. Give yourself a minute. Give me a minute.
You can't give yourself the luxury of night watch when it's your own. Goodbye, Francois. Goodbye, Gina.
Thank you. Without you, I would not have lasted.
Bring back Denise. It would be a shame not to after having kept her to life. Goodbye.
One who couldn't bear it any longer.
Thank you.
back. We have come back to tell you, and now we are standing here, ill at ease, not knowing what to say, how to say it,
because we came from a place where words had a different meaning.
Words to say simple things. To be cold, to be thirsty, to be hungry, to be tired, to need sleep, to be afraid, to live, to die.
If you don't understand us, don't think we've resented. We knew you wouldn't understand.
Why should you believe those stories of ghosts? Ghosts who have come back and who are not able to explain how. But these stories are true. These horrors did happen. These horrors do happen. Who will carry the word?